you who are with us virtually, welcome. I was with you last week. I was sitting on the couch with a cup of coffee, getting very frustrated at the buffering. We later found out that there was a problem with AT&T outside of the church, so hopefully we will not have that problem again this week. As we begin this morning, would you stand with me as I read from Psalm 98? Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done incredibly marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst with jubilant songs of music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Sing for joy before the Lord the King. This morning we are worshiping our God because he has done great things. Let's worship him together.
Come as far as he has the great need.
weeks where it seems as if everything has gone wrong, where life has been turned upside down, where we can catalog the hardships that we have had to face, situations we could have never imagined having to endure to go through. And yet, Father, hopefully, as we look back on these last few weeks, we are able to see you have done some incredibly great things. It's been encouraging to see Kevin Reese here, who just a few weeks ago was needing heart surgery, and physically he was in decline. And now to see his recovery and to see that he's back at work, you have done great things. For Jackie needing a liver transplant and going up to Minnesota, and within a few days, you did a great thing. You provided a liver. You had the doctors put that liver into her body, and her body began to function again as it's supposed to. It hasn't always been easy for her, but it is an incredible miracle that you performed. And I've heard so many other stories of how you have shown yourself to be real in the lives of your people. And so, Father, as we come to this place, we come not so much to receive something from you. Our purpose in worship is to come and to bring something to you, to bring to you the sacrifice of our lips, the fruit of our praise rising up to you. Because you are a God who is great. You are a God who has done great things for us. And as we look into the future, as we look into the next season, we know that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. We know that you will continue to do great things in our lives. So, Father, this morning, we worship you. In the name of your Son, Jesus, amen.
Thank you.
later on if we have enough time, if I think about it, if I want to, maybe we will get to that. Heard a story about a young couple that moved into a small town. And they figured the best way to get to know people is to go to church. And so they went to the small church in the small town. Truth is, they hadn't been in any church for many, many years. Sitting in the back row, not exactly sure what was going on, what to expect, they leaned forward and tapped the shoulder of an older gentleman in front of them and asked him, "Sir, what time does the service begin?" The old gentleman replied, "The service begins in about an hour when the preacher is done talking. I like that view of the church. I like the view that church isn't just something that happens an hour on Sunday morning. Church isn't something just inside the walls. No, church is the living and breathing and functioning body of Jesus Christ." Maybe one of the unintended consequences of this coronavirus, of the social distancing and the isolation, maybe one of the results of having to do church different than normal is we realize that church is important to us. We understand that it isn't just an hour on Sunday morning, but it's something that we need 24/7. It isn't just something within the walls here. It's something outside of the walls. That each of us have an important part to play in the church, in the body of Christ. That there is something we ought to be doing for this body of Christ to be functioning, to be as effective as possible. This is what the Apostle Paul is going to talk to us about this morning in Ephesians chapter 4. If you would, I invite you to turn with me in your copy of God's Word to Ephesians chapter 4. In Ephesians 4, Paul is talking about church. The last time we were together a couple of weeks ago, we were in the first six verses of Ephesians 4. We saw that within the church of Jesus Christ, there is to be unity. As Paul said in verse 3, "Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace." We can't create this unity. No, it's already been created by the Spirit of God. The only thing we can do is destroy it or keep it. Keep the unity. And in verses 4 to 6, you see those statements, those one statements. He says one seven times, one, 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 one. And we get the idea that in the church of Jesus Christ, there is a oneness, that we are called to unity. But be careful, unity isn't uniformity. Yes, there is unity in the church of Christ, but there is also to be diversity. And this morning, Paul is going to speak about one kind of diversity that there is to be within the church of Jesus Christ. Pick it up with me in Ephesians chapter 4. In verse 7, Paul writes and he says, "But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. Each and every one of you have been given a grace. Everyone and each of you has been given a grace." Christ has given each of us a grace. He has determined what that grace is and how much of that grace we will receive. What is this grace? Grace is one of those words that can mean a lot of different things. This afternoon, you might venture out to a restaurant for Sunday afternoon lunch, and you might be sitting at the table, and somebody might say, "Let's say grace." When the debutante walks into the ballroom, somebody might say she carries herself with such grace. Grace can mean a lot of different things. But in the Bible, grace typically means an enablement, an empowerment, a capacity. Paul speaks of God's sufficient grace. He describes the hardships that he is going through. Physical hardships, spiritual hardships, wars with the critics outside of the church. And Paul lets us know that most people would throw in the towel. Most people would give up. But God's grace was sufficient. God gave him the enablement, the capacity, the ability to endure. Already in Ephesians chapter 2, we saw that we are saved by grace. An empowerment to come to salvation. Grace typically means an empowerment. You have been given a capacity. You have been given an ability. You have been given an enablement to serve the body of Christ. Perhaps you have heard of the term spiritual gift. This is what Paul is talking about. You who have been chosen and adopted by the Father, redeemed and forgiven by the Son, made safe and secure by the Spirit, as Paul describes for us in Ephesians chapter 1. You have been given a grace gift, a spiritual gift. This gift isn't a toy to be played with. It is a tool to be used. It's not a pill to rest our head on. It is a privilege to act upon. Each and every one of us has been given a grace gift, a spiritual gift. And these gifts are different. And even those who might have the same kind of giftedness, the gift is given in different amounts. Christ has apportioned it. Christ has determined what grace gift you will receive and how much of that grace gift you will receive, so that in the body of Christ, while there is a unity, there is also a diversity. You see that in the church family. You see that there are different people with different kinds of gifts. You see that we are different. If you don't believe me, just look at the person 6 feet away from you and tell them, boy, you are different. We are different. We have the worship team. They use the grace gift God has given to them, leading us in worship. You have bring us and given the grace gift of chicken thighs. What an amazing, amazing gift. Barbecuing chicken thighs for almost the whole church. You have Ruth, who spends hours up here each week cleaning and sanitizing the building. You have Walter Meadows, who has been a tireless servant of Christ and of his church for years. How many years have Danny and Shireen Bickham invested in the sons and daughters of Bayshore? You see, God has given each of us a different kind of gift, and those gifts come in differing amounts. Paul wants us to understand that if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you have been graced with an ability, a capacity, an enablement to serve the body of Christ. Now you might be wondering, what gives Christ the right to give these gifts? I know you would never ask that question, but maybe it is a question you have wondered. When you see somebody else serving in ways that you wish you could serve, maybe you've wondered, what gives Christ the right to give the various gifts? And what gives Christ the right to give these various gifts in various amounts? While we may never ask that question, Paul is going to answer it for us preemptively. Look at it in verse 8. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to the people. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions, or as the King James says, the lowest parts of the earth? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heaven in order to fill the whole universe. What gives Christ the right to give out these gifts? Paul quotes from the Old Testament. Maybe you see the quotation, the letters written in italic or a footnote in the margin. He quotes from Psalm chapter 68, Psalm 68 verse 18. In fact, Psalm 68 verse 18 is a Reader's Digest summary of the whole chapter of Psalm 68. Psalm 68 describes a warrior king who goes to a distant land to fight a battle. And this warrior king is victorious. He defeats the enemy. He conquers the foe. And he captures the loot. The booty is his. To the victor goes the spoils. And the warrior king returns home and he takes these spoils of war that he has won and he distributes them among those who are on his side, those who align themselves with him. What gives Christ the right to give us gifts in differing amounts? Paul says he is the warrior king who came and defeated the enemy, defeated Satan, defeated death, and now he is ascended into heaven, seated on the throne, exalted above all others. It is the ascension that gives him the right. We talk a lot about the crucifixion of Christ. We talk a lot about the resurrection of Christ. We should talk more about the ascension of Christ. For as Paul describes it in Acts chapter 2, in that sermon he gave on the day of Pentecost, it was the ascension that validated who Christ was. It was the ascension that authenticated him as being the Son of God. It was the ascension into heaven where he was seated on the throne, which established him to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It was the ascension that gave him the right to give us different gifts in differing amounts. Paul is going to drill a little deeper into this thought. In fact, in the next two verses, in verses 8, 9, and 10, he is going to talk about the ascension, and then in verse 11, he is going to talk about the giving of gifts. Notice what Paul says about the ascension. You see those words again in verse 8. This is why it says, he ascended on high, he took many captives, and gave gifts. And then Paul gives this parenthetical thought. He has this parenthesis, this sidebar statement, where he says, what does he ascended mean? Except that he descended to the lowest part of the earth. He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. This is one of those verses that causes would-be Bible scholars to absolutely salivate. What are these lower earthly regions? What is this lowest part of the earth? Inquiring minds want to know. There are really three options. Some see this descent to the lower parts of the earth as simply being the incarnation. Jesus' birth in Bethlehem. I mean, talk about a descent. He left the glories of heaven and he walked that quiet stairway of life to be laid in Bethlehem's manger, surrounded by livestock. Talk about a descent. Others see the descent a little bit lower. Maybe this is talking about his crucifixion and his burial. He was put into the ground. Maybe that is the lowest part of the earth. Others see the descent even lower. They will take this verse written by Paul. They will take it kicking and screaming out of context, and they will connect it to a verse that Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 and 19. They will take that verse, ripping and screaming out of context, and then they will take what Peter said and what Paul said and try to put it together, and they will suggest that Christ descended into the very bowels of hell. They look at the life of Christ and say, well, when did he do this? And they will put forth the theory that from the time of his burial to the time of his resurrection, during the 3 days when he was dead, between his death and resurrection, he went into hell on a victory lap, taunting the evil spirits and the enemies who were opposed to him. Certainly, there are some problems with that view. David tells us that he descended to the lowest parts of the earth. Jonah, when he was swallowed by the big fish and taken down into the depths of the Mediterranean Sea, he says that he went to the lowest part of the earth. Did David or Jonah go to hell? I don't think so. And I don't think that this necessitates that Christ, to go to the lowest part, went to hell. Well, what does it mean that he descended to the lowest part? Let me give you the correct answer. Or rather, let Paul give the correct answer. See, the book of Ephesians is a prison epistle. It's a letter that Paul wrote when he was under house arrest in Rome. At the same time, with the same pen, with the same parchment, he wrote three other letters. Actually, two letters and a postcard. He wrote Ephesians, he wrote Philippians and Colossians, and then that small postcard we know as Philemon. Turn a page to the right, a page or two to the right, to the book of Philippians. Philippians chapter 2 was a letter that was written with the same pen, the same parchment, at the same time as Ephesians. And in Philippians chapter 2, verse 6, we see the descent of Christ, the kenosis, it's called, the emptying of Christ. It says, Christ, who being the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be used for his own advantage. And in my text, I drew an arrow pointing down. It's a step down. He took another step down, verse 7, rather, he made himself nothing. He took another step down by taking the very nature of a servant. He took another step down, being made in the likeness, human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He even took another step down. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to death. Not just any death, but death on the cross. He took another step down, dying on the cross. And then in verse 9, you see the U-turn. After this descent to death on the cross, we see the U-turn where it begins to speak of his ascension. Therefore, God exalted him in the highest place. And there I draw an arrow pointing up. It's a step up. And gave him the name that is above every name. In ascension, a step up. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Step up. In heaven and on earth and under the earth, step up. And that every tongue should acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. It seems to me that if Christ ascended to the bowels of hell, this would have been a perfect place for Paul to tell us. Well, I think in Paul's mind, as he writes Philippians and with the same pen and parchment at the same time as he writes Ephesians, I think Paul is letting us know that Christ descended to death on the cross. Funny thing is, pages and pages and pages, books are written about this descent of Christ and how low did he go, how far did he descend. But that isn't what Paul is emphasizing. Paul isn't so much concerned about the descent of Christ as he is about the ascent of Christ, about the exaltation of Christ. He only descended so that he could ascend. For it is in the ascension that he is given the right to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the conquering warrior king, he is able to give different gifts in different amounts to people in this church. Verses 8 to 10, Paul focuses our attention on the ascension of Christ. And then in verse 11, he draws our attention to the giving of gifts. Look at it in verse 11. So Christ himself gave the apostles, prophets, the evangelists, the pastor teachers. He gave these gifts. Four particular gifts that Paul mentions here. These aren't the only gifts. I mean, you can read Romans chapter 12, and there's a long list of gifts. You can read 1 Corinthians 12, and there's a long list of gifts. Ephesians was written after Romans and 1 Corinthians. If I was Paul, I would have taken all those gifts I already listed and made a long catalog of spiritual gifts. The gifts from Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians 4, all listed. Wouldn't help God's people to see all of these gifts in one place? And then we can see what gift is our gifts, but Paul doesn't do that. He doesn't give us a complete, exhaustive list of spiritual gifts. Maybe because there isn't a complete, exhaustive list of spiritual gifts. Maybe because in different times, in different places, in different eras, there would be different needs in the church. Differing kinds of people with differing kinds of gifts. The church of Ephesus didn't need somebody who was gifted in electronic communications. We do. The church of Ephesus didn't need somebody who could handle the Facebook live streaming. We need somebody gifted like that. You see, it's not a complete and exhaustive list of gifts. Nowhere in the Bible. Because in different times, different ages, the church would have different needs. And God would give grace to different people to meet those needs in the church. He doesn't give us a particular list of gifts and encourage us to figure out which one is ours. Because before we do that, we must first accept the truth that I have been gifted. You have been gifted. Each and every one of us has been graced by God with an enablement, a capacity to serve the church of Jesus Christ. Amen. You have been gifted. Let me draw out some thoughts from this. Some lessons that maybe will drive this a little bit further home. Lesson number one is this. We do not choose our gift. I wish I could, but I can't. We don't choose our gift. Christ knows what this church will need, and Christ will gift those people to the church. It's curious in verse 11. What is the gift in verse 11? You see those words, apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastor, teachers, but are those the gifts? What is it that Christ gives to the church? He gives people to the church. He gives somebody a capacity, and then he gives that person as a gift to the church. We do not choose the capacity that he gives to us. Wish I could. I wish I could have the gift of evangelism. I really wanted that gift, especially in college. I read all about evangelism. I studied evangelism. I went to seminars on evangelism. On most Tuesday nights during my junior and senior year of college, I and a handful of other friends, we would go to a neighboring university, either the University of Dayton or Wright State University. We would play in some pickup basketball games, hang around in the snack shop, might even venture into the library, just trying to find other college students to have evangelistic conversations with them. As I look back on that experience, That was totally frustrating to me. I was totally ineffective in doing that. I didn't want to be ineffective. I studied. I took the courses. I took the seminars. I was just ineffective. I had a friend named Rick. Rick didn't know how to evangelize. Never read a book. Never went to a seminar. He didn't even know the first two questions you were supposed to ask somebody. If you were to die tonight, you know for sure you would go to heaven. And if you were to stand before God right now, he were to ask you, why should I let you into my kingdom? What would you say to God? Rick didn't know that. And yet I never met anybody who led more people to Christ than Rick. I always wanted the gift of evangelism. I would go to some pastor's conference and the keynote speaker, I don't know how many times they would get up and they would say, yeah, before I came here, I got on the plane as I was sitting in the terminal, I asked God if I could lead the person sitting in the same row as me, if I could lead them to Christ. And sure enough, before we touched down, I had led that person to Christ. Oh, wow. How do you do that? I wanted to try that. And so I prayed, God, help me lead the person in the row next to me to Christ. I got on the plane at Corpus Christi International Airport, began the conversation, quickly discovered that the two people in the row next to me were both pastors. I wanted the gift of evangelism, but we don't choose our gift. Christ knows what his church needs. He gives you that grace. That grace gift in whatever amount for you to be a gift to his church. The second part, the results are up to God. The results aren't up to us. The results are up to God. If God is the one who gives the gift and he gives it in various amounts, then the results of the use of that gift really isn't up to us. It's up to God. All that is required of us is faithfulness. Faithful stewards of the gift that God has given to us. And so if you are involved in a ministry and everything is going wonderful, it's dynamic, there's incredible results, you don't get the credit. And if you're involved in a ministry, it becomes frustrating, you don't see the results that you wanted, you don't get the blame. The results aren't up to us. The only thing required of a steward is to be faithful. We do not choose our gift, therefore the results are up to God. Thirdly, you do not need to know your gift before you use it. I can even say you will not know your gift until you start using it. There have been a number of times when I've approached somebody about a ministry opportunity. I will present the ministry need, and I would say, I think this is something you might be able to do. And they might say, oh, Pastor, I just don't know if I am gifted in that area. Let me do some study to see if I'm gifted in that area, and then maybe I will give it a try. I will always say to them, you will never know if you're gifted in this area until you serve. You serve in a variety of ways. Serve in different areas and then step back and evaluate. See which of those areas of ministry are invigorating to you and which of those areas are draining to you. See which of those areas people come along and affirm you and they say to you, I really see God using you in doing this. You do not need to know your gift before you begin serving. In fact, you will not know your gift until you have started to serve. Besides that, there are some things we are responsible for, even if they aren't our gift. You can take a piece of paper and you can draw a line down the middle of that piece of paper. On the left column, you can list all of the spiritual gifts in Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians 4, list them all. And for a vast majority of these gifts, you can go through the pages of Scripture and you can see a command that goes along with that gift. So that even if you aren't gifted in that area, you are still commanded to do it. For example, there is the gift of hospitality. Some are incredibly hospitable kinds of people. It's their giftedness. It just oozes out of their body. You can see it all over them. They are hospitable people. They make great 2-for-2 hosts. They have the gift of hospitality, and yet all of us are commanded to be hospitable, even if you aren't gifted. Some have the gift of mercy. They are just able to be so empathetic with folks and be right with them in that time of need, but we are all commanded to show mercy to each other. Some have the gift of giving. May their tribe increase. Some have the gift of being generous with their finances, and yet we are all commanded to be generous with our finances. You will not know your gift. You do not need to know your gift before you begin to serve. In fact, you will not know your gift until you start serving. Let me make a fourth conclusion. Everybody is responsible for something. Each of us has been given a gift by God. The warrior king has come and he defeated the enemy and he ascended into heaven and he is exalted on the throne and he has dispensed gifts among those who have aligned themselves with him. Therefore, each and every one of us, everyone in each of us is responsible for something. One last statement. There are no little jobs. There are no little people, and there are no little jobs. There are no little people, there are no little jobs. All there is faithfulness and unfaithfulness. Billy Graham was not God's teacher's pet. Martin Luther, Apostle John, Mother Teresa, Chuck Swindoll, Chris Tomlis, whoever your spiritual hero is, they were not God's little spiritual pet. James is very clear. With God, there is no favoritism. There is no partiality. What these people have been able to accomplish is the result of what God has given to them. What you will be able to accomplish is the result of what God has given to you. All we do and all we have is from God. Now, I know that the impact of Billy Graham is vastly different than the impact of David Lewis. Billy Graham was able to influence millions. But while his impact was different, the importance is just the same. And the reward is just the same. In eternity, we will not be evaluated based on impact. We will be evaluated based on faithfulness. Have we faithfully used the divine enablement, the grace, the gift that God has given to us? Christ was the warrior king who came to earth and defeated the enemy. He ascended into heaven, seated on the throne, exalted. And he has dispensed among you, his people, who have aligned with him. He has given you a gift. The question is, will we unwrap that gift and use that gift? When does the service begin? Oh, I almost forgot I have this sitting up here. Some of you might recognize this. This was a gift given to me last August for my 25th anniversary. The mistake that was made was it was handed to me on Sunday morning. And so it went to the place where most things go that are handed to me on Sunday morning, to the corner of the sound booth, right on the floor. That's where I throw my sermon manuscripts after I'm done preaching. And so this got buried underneath a stack of sermon manuscripts. It's a wonderful gift. It's a volume of writings by my favorite theologian, Charles Schulz, the creator of Snoopy and Charlie Brown and the gang. But I never opened it. I forgot about it until a couple of weeks ago when Christina and Ruth were deep cleaning the church and Josiah, the Old Testament king, found the scrolls. They found Charles Schulz for me. I wonder how many of us have taken that gift that Jesus Christ came to earth to fight for, ascended into heaven, seated on the throne, and out of the goodness and the kindness of his heart, he has said to us, "Here, I am giving you this gift. And more than that, I am making you a gift to my church." Isn't it time that we unwrap the gift to be used by our warrior king in his church? Let's go to our God in prayer. Father, help us to be this kind of church. Help us to be a church that is together in unity, but yet we also champion diversity within the gifts, where people feel the freedom to serve you in the ways you have gifted them, where they are free to edify the body, to build up the body, to encourage the saints by creating a place of freedom where folks can come as gifts from you to be used in your church. Yes, Father, there are things we as a church need to do to make this a place where people are able to use their gifts in the lives of others, but there's also something each of us needs to do. We need to be faithful in using that ability, that enablement, that capacity that you have given to us for your church. Father, use us to your glory. In Jesus' name. Let's stand together.
This is my dear.
agenda. You may be seated. This is the time where we usually pass the offering plates, but we are not doing that. There are offering plates scattered around the lobby, or there is the silver box in the wall there behind the connecting sign. You can slide your gift in there. God has been good. People that have been faithful in their giving. Giving certainly has decreased some, but God is still good and providing for our needs. So thank you. Thank you, church, for being involved in that. If you are new to Bayshore, if you are here, first time here, there are some sign-up cards out in the lobby. They said, you are welcome. If you could give us that information, we would love to see how we can serve you as a church family. Also, we'd love to see from you what your giftedness and in what ways God has brought you to us for you to build up his body here. If you are watching online, there's a form you can fill out where we will get your information and be able to contact you as well. Hopefully, very, very soon, we will be back to normal schedule with children's ministries going on Sunday morning and youth ministry and women's Bible studies and men's Bible studies. Hopefully, we'll be able to be at that point soon. Be patient with us. We will err on the side of caution because we love you and we love our community as well. If there is anything we can do for you as a church family, please, please let us know. You join me in prayer. Father, thank you for bringing us together as a church family. Thank you for the faith, the content of truth that binds our hearts and minds together. Thank you for the Spirit of God who has brought us together as a family. And also thank you, Father, that we aren't a melting pot where everybody is the same, but it's more of a solid bowl where we are different and distinct from each other. You are able to use these differences to build a strong church. Do that work among us, our Father. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.